In this video, I'm going to break down combinatorics in the simplest way possible, using clear examples so you can understand and apply it much faster. We'll explore useful formulas, tree diagrams, and much more, so make sure you stick around until the end. Let's dive in. Combinatorics is the branch of mathematics that studies counting, arrangements, and different ways in which objects can be selected or organized. Let's start with the basic formulas in combinatorics, because they're the foundation for everything else we will do. The first important formula is for permutations, which are arrangements where the order matters. For example, suppose you have three letters, A, B, and C. The different ways you can arrange all three letters are ABC, ACB, BAC, BCA, CAB, and CBA. There are six arrangements in total, and we can calculate this using the formula n factorial, where the n stands for all the elements in a given context, written as n with an exclamation mark, which means multiplying all whole numbers from n down to 1. So for three letters, 3 factorial equals 3 times 2 times 1, which is 6. If you only want to arrange some of the objects and not all of them, then you use the formula for partial permutations, which is n factorial divided by the letter n minus r factorial. And the letter r stands for the number of elements you want to arrange. This helps us count sequences quickly without listing every possibility. Next, we have combinations, which are selections where the order does not matter. For example, suppose you want to choose two friends from a group of 4 to form a team. Choosing Anna and Ben is the same as choosing Ben and Anna, so we only count it once. How many possible pairs can be formed here? The formula for combinations is n choose r, written as ncr, or just nnr below each other and between brackets, which equals n factorial divided by r factorial times n minus r factorial. The r factorial in the denominator makes sure that nothing is counted more than once. In this case, we calculate 4 choose 2, which equals 6. This means there are 6 unique groups of 2 people. Understanding the difference between permutations and combinations is crucial in combinatorics because it changes the way we count arrangements or selections. Now that we have covered the key formulas, let's see how we can visualize counting problems. One of the most common ways is using tree diagrams. A tree diagram is a branching structure that shows all possible choices step by step. Imagine again the example of choosing an outfit. Suppose you have 3 shirts and 2 pairs of pants. Then there are 2 steps, first choosing a shirt and then choosing a pair of pants. First, draw 3 branches. These will represent the choices you can make for the shirts. You draw 3 lines because you have 3 shirts. Then, from each shirt, draw 2 branches for the pants because when you choose a shirt, you still have 2 choices for the pants you want to wear. If you count all the branches at the end, you will see there are 6 possible outfits. Tree diagrams are especially useful because they make abstract counting very concrete and easy to follow. Sometimes, however, tree diagrams can become very large and complicated. In that case, we often simplify them by focusing only on the number of branches at each level rather than drawing every single outcome. Let me show you what I mean. For example, in the shirts and pants case, instead of drawing all 6 paths, you can simply note that the first choice has 3 options and the second choice has 2 options, then multiply them. This simplified version is often called a reduced tree diagram, and it helps us add up the totals more quickly without clutter. Another useful visualization is the grid diagram, also called a lattice diagram. You can think of a grid as a set of steps you can take. Let's go through an example to make this clear. Suppose a football match ended with a score of 3-2. In how many different ways could that result have happened? We will call the first team Team 1 and the second team Team 2. Now imagine a grid where the vertical axis represents the goals of Team 1 and the horizontal axis represents the goals of Team 2. Since Team 1 scored 3 goals, the grid will be 3 units tall. Since Team 2 scored 2 goals, the grid will be 2 units wide. Next, we fill in the grid with numbers that show how many possible ways there are to reach each score. For example, if the score is 1-0, that can only happen in one way. The same is true for 2-0, 3-0, 0-1, and 0-2. Each of those can also happen in only one way. But what about the score 1-1? In this case, there are two different possibilities. It could have been 1-0 first, followed by 1-1. Or it could have been 0-1 first, and then 1-1. To make filling in the grid easier, we do not have to think through every possibility one by one. Instead, we can simply add the number directly below and the number directly to the left. The sum of those two gives us the new number for that grid position. Now we can just do it for the whole grid, and on the top right, we should get our answer. And the answer is 10, so the match could have happened in 10 different ways. Another important concept in combinatorics is the complement, often written as not P. The complement is useful because sometimes it is easier to count the outcomes you do not want, and then subtract those from the total instead of directly counting the outcomes you do want. Let's take the example of flipping 3 coins. Suppose we want to know how many possibilities there are where we get at least one head. If we try to count this directly, we would need to think about all the different cases. Maybe one head, maybe 2 heads, or even 3 heads. That quickly becomes messy. Instead, let's use the complement. The opposite of at least one head is no heads at all. That means all 3 coins land tails. There's only one way for that to happen. Tail, tail, tail. Now, how many total outcomes are there when flipping 3 coins? Each coin has 2 possibilities, so we calculate 2 times 2 times 2, which equals 8. Out of those 8 outcomes, only one has no heads. So we subtract the complement from the total. 8 minus 1 equals 7. That means there are 7 possible outcomes that contain at least one head. This method is much faster and cleaner than listing all the cases. And that is why the complement rule is such an important tool in combinatorics. A big thank you to this user for leaving this wholesome comment. I hope you now have a better grasp of combinatorics, and thanks everyone for watching. We'll be right back.